Hello there. My name is Martin Conway. Welcome to Contacts with Conway with a Difference. During the lockdown period, I've obviously not had access to patients and my normal consulting room equipment. So in this series, I'll be in conversation with leading figures from the contact lens world around the world. The first of which is my old friend, Pat Caroline from Pacific University in Oregon, and has been involved in the research of eye shape and contact lens design for as long as I can remember. You joined the conversation with Pat as I have asked him the question, how long has he actually been involved with scleral lenses? If you would prefer to watch this video with English or Spanish subtitles, please go to the cog in the bottom right-hand corner of the screen and press to select your preferred options.
Well, you know, our work began in about 2009, and really, compared to the rest of the world, we were very, very late. Individuals like Don Ezekiel and Perry Rosenthal had been using early versions of scleral lenses for actually many years. Actually started out back in the early days of the Boston 2 material, which actually became the first material for a scleral lens with all its, you know, decay limitations and everything.
Yeah, I mean, when we first started working together, there were basically spherical lenses, spherical peripheries in the main. Mm-hmm. And we were concerned, if I remember, about oxygen, whether we were getting enough oxygen through the material and through the subsequent tear layer. And we did a series of experiments with you at Pacific.
That's
Do you remember
right.
those? And where we fitted patients, I don't know, I can't recall exactly how many, but we fitted patients with the identical lenses, but we did them in a range of different decay materials. And if I remember, it clearly demonstrated that the higher the decay, the less swelling we got underneath the scleral lenses, which pointed us as Contamac in the direction that we wanted to go, which is, you know, developing a higher decay material with scleral lenses in mind specifically. Initially, I think we were concerned that this was going to be a flash in the pan, that we were going to do a lot of developmental work, a lot of cost involved, and it was going to remain a very specialized small market. You know, how wrong could we have been at that point? It simply exploded after that. One of the earlier issues that we encountered and we asked you to investigate was fogging.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe you'd like to sort of bring us up to date on where we are with that now.
Well, it's still a very much an intriguing topic. You know, we our incidence of fogging when we first came out with the initial scleral lenses was very high. It was probably in the area of around 30 to 35% of our patients.
Those are the figures that I remember. I think it was.
Yeah, and then we switched over to using the toric haptic and creating a call it a more sealed lens. Our early work with OCT imaging and scleral shape showed us clearly that there's about 150 micron differential in scleral height between the two principal meridians of the sclera. And therefore, when we went to the 150 micron differential in the haptic shape, we noticed rather quickly that our incidence of fogging went down rather significantly. Still today, it's a problem probably in about 10% of individuals.
So it really is a question of making a better seal around the around the scleral on the first one.
Anecdotally, that seems to be the case, that there's some type of contaminant coming in from the sclera, from the bulbar conjunctiva, that seems to be contaminating the tear film. Now, we did a lot of studies a number of years ago on that and found that it wasn't a protein underneath there, but actually a lipid. When we stained these fog lenses with oil red O, a lipid-specific stain, it really did demonstrate that compared to normal patients with no fogging, those with fogging had significant amounts of increase in lipid contamination underneath the lenses. When we started narrowing down that limbal clearance, we definitely noticed a significant decrease in the lipid. So that kind of told us that the contaminant is probably entering in from the bulbar.
Rather than the inside, yeah. I remember back the concept of fitting either close to or even a mild touch on the peripheral cornea was just not acceptable in the marketplace. And so, although I think that kind of fitting is still being used in and around Europe, the US market and the markets that have developed subsequently.
It's always hard when we are constantly hearing the fact that we need limbal clearance. We need limbal clearance. And I got to admit, that's an area we've really not studied. It's become sort of anecdotal in our industry. And our industry is noted for that. That is just repeating what other individuals have said from the podium without any real substantial research into what is the optimum amount of clearance in the peripheral cornea and limbus.
But I think inadvertently we were sealing the cornea, the tear layer from the external contaminants without realizing what we were doing. So we achieved the result, but not by design. It was really just by chance. And what you're now doing by designing the periphery around the actual scleral shape, you're achieving much the same result.
Well, most of what we do in clinic is by chance. There's no doubt that we've had to relearn scleral lenses since few of us were actually trained with PMMA scleral lenses. We really did have to learn a lot of this from scratch. And I think today though now, the peripheral designs on these lenses, the haptic designs and so on are really pretty darn good. We've been very impressed with how the industry has responded to these.
I think I've said it before, but I've never ever known a lens modality which has undergone so much intense research and development. If you look at where we are now versus where we were in 2010 through 2012, it's miles better. I've never seen that rapid a development. Partly fueled by the success in the marketplace and competition, particularly in the US market. But also, I think advances in instrumentation have led that research and led our understanding of the shape that we're actually fitting the lenses to. Pacific have led the research. They're known for research into metrology, and that you must get to play with every new gadget that comes out. What can you tell us about that? What's in the pipeline now that you've got access to that the rest of us could only wish for?
Well, we're still playing around a lot with scleral shape. We have the Iglet system and the SMAP 3D. which are profilometry based systems for measuring scleral shape. We also have OCT images, and those do need to be added to that list because a lot of the work we did early on was with OCT imaging, which is more of a direct physical measurement of the shape of the sclera. Although all three instruments seem to be providing some really good information about scleral shape and about the fact that there's a tremendous variety in scleral shapes in the marketplace, even in normal eyes. So we've got a lot to learn yet in that area.
Thank you for watching this new conversational type format of video. If you've enjoyed the new format, please remember to give this video a like, share it with your friends, and subscribe to our channel. Thank you very much for watching, and look forward to seeing you again in the future.